Hello again. Welcome to another ISSA talk. You know me by now. I am Jenny Scott, ISSA master trainer and product developer. I make all those amazing courses that you love. I'm so excited because as you can see, I love fitness, wearables, and tracking. Mm-hmm. And today we're joined by somebody who loves fitness and dare I say it more than I do, which is hard, but it's possible. Mm-hmm. Our amazing expert today has had quite the impressive career in health and technology, and he's currently the Senior Vice President of Biostrap. I could go on and on about this guy, but please welcome to ISSA Talk, Elias Arjan. Hello, Elias.
Hi, Jenny. Really excited to be here. Thank you for having me.
Absolutely. So yes, you know a lot about wearable technology, and I'm super excited to pick your brain because like I said, I love this technology and what it can show us, but I'm sure I'm missing some things. So first of all, what is a wearable?
So as you just highlighted, most people are familiar with some type of wearable technology, typically like worn on a wrist, so like a smartwatch or some type of health tracker. But wearable technology could literally be anything that's on your body. So it could be things that even look like a necklace, a ring, could clip to your ankle, your shoelaces, anything that you're using to record sort of biometric data around your health, your fitness, your movements. And all of these things, all of this data can be aggregated and then used to provide insights around human health. So, and actually we're even starting to add in animals. I might have seen recently some wearables are being released for pet tracking for your dogs and cats so that you can even know their biometric signals. That's some emerging technology that's coming out.
Oh, cool. So it's not just if they get lost, you can find them again.
Yeah. You could actually even monitor their health in the same way you can monitor your own health or your family's health with wearable tech.
Oh, interesting. We might have to chat later about that because I have a 15-year-old cattle dog over here who probably could use some monitoring. She's just fine, though. She's never going to die. So you're mentioning like necklaces and rings. I think I've seen those rings. I think my mom has one for tracking her heart because she's having some heart issues. Right. But so smartwatches like mine are different than a wearable fitness tracker, right?
Yeah. So there's a lot of different categories. And I would say just like anything else, it's kind of like a wide spectrum. So on one end, you have maybe more what people are familiar with, which are like the smartwatch aspect, which are more like consumer devices. And then on the other side, you have like FDA cleared medical devices that are used predominantly by researchers and clinicians and in hospitals that they can provide patients for wearable tracking outside in an outpatient setting. Most people are more thinking about the consumer, but there's a lot of different types of wearables out there. Most people aren't even aware of all of the different options.
So let's talk about those options, Elias. So the consumer ones and the medical ones, what sort of metrics would you get from either or?
Well, I mean, one of the things to think what most people are using today are smartwatches that have a health monitoring aspect. So they're predominantly there to, in a way, replace your smartphone, right? So you're using it for your Spotify, for your texting, maybe for your phone calls. And then they have an aspect of it that they can track your run or give you heart rate. But those are a little bit more orientated around, you know, a multifunction, whereas like medical grade wearables are tend to be just really focused on clinical grade data for your health. And then in between, you have a couple of devices that are kind of trying to bridge that gap. They're going a little bit more deeper into health metrics. And maybe they don't have a face. They don't play Spotify. They don't give you text. They just give you health data. And then that data is probably a little bit more informative for, you know, health professionals and even for, we call them like prosumers, you know, people who want to have access to that professional grade data, even though they may not be a clinician, a doctor, or even a coach.
Absolutely. All right. Then this one counts as a prosumer device. Like it. Yeah. Like that title too.
Yeah. So that's like, because those are the prosumers. Those are people like a lot of probably the people watching this webinar, either coaches or, you know, more hardcore fitness people, you know, you want that health data. And for companies like us, like Biostrap and some of the other companies in that space, we're more interested in that health data and then empowering people. Our mission here, what we're trying to do at Biostrap and some of these other companies along the same lines, we want to democratize that clinical grade data. So you don't have to be a clinician. But I think for coaches, this is an important point because if you're making health decisions for your clients, you should be aware of what type of device you're using and where it falls on the spectrum. Because a lot of people have to understand those consumer devices, there is zero requirement for them to be accurate.
Absolutely. So
they can be giving you heart rate, but is it accurate heart rate? Is it accurate respiration rate? Is it accurate metrics? And then the health devices that are in the middle may be adding some metrics that are more complicated, right? Like heart rate variability. And so, you know, you have to kind of, there's a lot of education and learning. I mean, that's why I was excited to work with ISSA, because we did that chapter in the recovery certification on wearables. So as far as I know, that's one of the first times a fitness certification agency has included wearable tech in a training. And so I think it's great. This is a very rapidly evolving space.
Absolutely. Another industry first. And I actually was part of putting that chapter together after you wrote that content. Fabulous information. You even talked about a lot of the different brands and the common devices that are out there and what they track, how they track it, what type of light technology, that little light under there, what kind of light technology that they use. And I think it's super interesting, but there are a lot of them. So how would I know if I had a client that I wanted to recommend a device to, whether it's a consumer grade or a medical grade, how would I know which one's right for them?
Yeah, I mean, that's probably why I was happy to write that chapter, because it's a question that's kind of complex. And I think for coaches who want to work and start adapting wearables, there definitely is an education component there. I guess one of the big things to realize is probably the number one thing you want is obviously, it depends on your relationship with the client and their goals, ultimately. You know, the easiest one to use is obviously the one they already have. But if their goals are maybe more advanced, say, for example, a lot of these consumer devices that are smartwatches don't really go deep into things like recovery metrics and more of the more, you know, complicated HRV metrics and then how to use those. So, you know, you kind of need to learn and educate yourself as a trainer and then decide, you know, well, for this person, I want to go deeper with them, especially if that's the type of individual that you think you can, you know, you can take down that path. Not everybody is going to want to go there, but I think eventually we will. I think the market is changing. People are changing. The wearable technology is expanding at a massively, like last year was the biggest growth, I think, because of the pandemic in the history of wearable tech. So, and remote monitoring.
Absolutely. So, I mean, the technology is available. It's out there and it's relatively easy to get to. I don't know about you. I see ads for things all the time, different devices, but would you ever, this is kind of more of a personal question on my end, actually, because like this device, I won't name it, but this device, if you might recognize it, it has a membership fee to have it. I've had it for a year and a half now, and I absolutely love it. I use the metrics every single morning. It's the first thing I look at in the morning, last thing I look at night. I track my workouts religiously. But I always tell people, they ask me about it, what is that? But when I tell them about it, I say, don't get it unless you're actually going to use the information. Would you agree with that?
Yeah, I would. And I would agree, maybe this is where the coaches come in. So if you are a fitness coach right now and you're thinking, you know, how do I differentiate myself in the market? You know, you can also help people with that data, because I personally think that there's going to be a whole new segment of professionals that are open around things like sleep coaching and recovery coaching, because wearables like what you're wearing and what Biostrap does, we're giving people insights in these areas that they've never had access to before. And people want that data, but they don't maybe have the background in exercise physiology to understand how to make it actionable. So some companies are going down a path where they think, you know, they're going to do it with AI. And I think maybe even some fitness coaches might be concerned, oh, geez, you know, is AI going to replace the fitness coach? I was a personal trainer. I work in wearable tech. I, you know, am an advocate in the biohacking community. And I actually think we're going to need people, because what we're talking about is behavioral change. It's very hard for an AI device to create behavioral change.
Absolutely agreed. So it sounds like you're opening up, like these devices are opening up a whole new market for trainers. Right. So if somebody has a device, you can offer a service where you help them understand their data or you check in on it regularly for them. That's really cool. I never thought about that.
Yeah, I think that's really what we're trying to do at Biostrap. We have the remote monitoring program where if you actually even only have, we give free access for up to 5 people for them to monitor, because we really believe in pioneering this idea. So we would like people to start trying this out, even if this is for your family and you maybe want to see how your parents are doing. They're elder, you're, you know, with the pandemic, you can't visit them, but you want to make sure they're okay. You know, you can be monitoring their vitals at a distance. So this is going to become something that, you know, was telehealth, but I actually think it's going to move into I think it's going to hit every industry eventually. And I think fitness pros right now are in a great position to be early on, because if you're coaching people around their, you know, their workouts, well, why aren't you coaching them around their sleep and their recovery? Because that's going to make their workouts more effective. And you need to look at that whole, we just couldn't do it before. You know, I was a personal trainer 30 years ago and, you know, we didn't have a lot of tools. You know, it was like more reps, you know, less reps, heavier weight, you know, less weight. Like, I mean, there's a couple levers we could push, but they now there's so much more.
Absolutely. Great point. Yeah, there's so much that we don't have access to or we didn't before that now we do. But as trainers, we have to learn about it. So I'm super excited that that was part of our recovery course and we can make it a big part. It's the last chapter and it's one of the bigger chapters. So thank you for your input on that, by the way.
Oh, it was a pleasure. I was just excited to see somebody, yay, somebody's finally like taking this on, because I personally believe, again, because of my background as a personal trainer, I think this is the opportunity for coaches right now to get in on this. Because, you know, if you, again, coming back to this idea, I mean, a lot of my work in my career has been around behavioral change and behavioral science, whether it's like corporate training, personal training, managing teams. And it's all around the fact that if you're going to change people's behavior, the best people to do it are people, right? It's not, the technology isn't going to do it by itself. So I think if you're listening to this and you're a coach and you're kind of thinking, well, should I learn more about wearable tech? I would strongly encourage you to go down that path. Again, ISSA has the only chapter that I know of in the recovery certification where you can access that information in one place. Otherwise, you kind of have to go through the internet rabbit holes of finding it on your own.
That's awesome. So you mentioned that like the technology has blossomed already, but it's still growing. Where do you see the future of wearables as it relates to fitness?
Okay. Well, first off, let me just frame how big the market is, just so people, because they may not realize. So right now it's around $17 billion a year and it's growing. Last year it grew 30% in because of the pandemic in 2020. It's growing about 20% a year. So Basically, and that's across the world. So this isn't just the phenomena in Western countries, even developing countries are starting to pick up wearable tech. It's really just going to keep growing. So the opportunity is massive. And so where I think it's going is we're going to a place where I'm sure some people might have heard of this idea of, you know, very bio-individually targeted drugs, right? So there's maybe people have heard about like this idea where we could look at your DNA and then we could create a, say, a drug or a treatment program that's targeted to that individual. I believe we're going to go to bio-individual fitness programs with this technology. So you would now be able to not just create group fitness in the way that it's always been done, but as a coach, you can look at people and you can literally tell them, you know, they could, a combination of the coach, the technology, and then the individual, we could say, here's your exact heart rate zones for this workout. And that can all be shown on a screen. You can look at what intensity the workout should be at beforehand based upon the recovery scores. So this whole opportunity for us to get really much better outcomes for our clients, our patients, because it's all based on bio-individuality.
That's awesome. You guys heard it first here. I absolutely agree. If we can prevent things, if we can help make things more efficient, it's going to help people in the long run. That's really cool. Are you guys working on anything that does that stuff right now? I mean, can you tell us that?
Well, I think the thing is because the space is so big, you know, as a company, we're a rapidly growing company and we're, you know, going to take our piece of this, and it's not going to be one company is going to kind of solve the whole thing. It's going to take a whole group. And I think where we're going now, and if you look at the statistics, again, some more staggering statistics, you know, 6 out of 10 Americans have some form of chronic disease. And 2 out of those 6 have 2 or more. So there's a lot of like chronic disease and it's in on the rise, right? Obesity is on the rise. This is why we need all you fitness coaches, right? You got to help us with this. And So I think in the wearable space, what we're trying to do is get to the point where we can actually, you know, you would have a notification essentially like a year before that you're on a path to obesity, you're on a path to type 2 diabetes, a path to cardiovascular decline. And so, you know, it's no longer waiting until the doctor says, oh, by the way, you're now diagnosed with a condition. It's like, let's go much further back. Let's go into prevention. Let's go into not just treatment, because our whole system, our whole healthcare system, is really kind of driven by, you know, once you discover a condition, you treat it. And the fitness community is trying to fill the gap by getting people to be active and exercise more. But maybe if wearable technology can come in here and tell people like, hey, you really need to go and start working out, because our vital monitoring system is looking at your health on the inside, and you're at risk of going down into a chronic disease. Hopefully that's the motivation they need to bring in a trainer and start working out.
Very cool. Awesome information, Elias. Thank you so much for your insight into these products.
Oh, my pleasure. And I'm really happy that you're sort of spreading the news. And, you know, I just want to end on the idea that, I mean, if you are a fitness trainer, I really do think now is the time to sort of jump on and start looking at this technology and getting yourselves familiar with it. Don't be afraid of it. It's going to be your friend and ally.
That's awesome. Well, thank you so much again, Elias. And thank you guys for watching. Be sure to join us for part two, because we're going to talk a little bit more about how consumers can actually use these devices. But we'll be talking to you guys next time. Thanks.
Bye, everyone.